And we return to the subject of health care reform. Even as Republicans are trying to shut off funding for the law, the Obama administration and some states are preparing for a pivotal new phase to take effect in October. That's when new exchanges or online insurance marketplaces are set to open. We've been trying to answer your frequently asked questions all week, and Ray Suarez leads the way again tonight.
We've spent some time laying out some of the basics of the exchanges and the premiums consumers might pay. But we're also getting a number of questions on other related financial issues, such as tax credits, taxes, and penalties still to come. And that's our focus tonight. And once again, Julie Rovner of NPR joins us. And Julie, to get people to do things and not do things, there are all kinds of incentives and disincentives baked into the law. What about these subsidies and tax credits? How do they work?
Well, the idea, of course, is that if you're going to require people to have insurance, then you want to make it affordable. So there are subsidies for people between 100% of poverty and 400% of poverty. Now, for an individual, that's about $11,000 to about $45,000 a year of income. For a family of four, it's about $23,000 all the way up to about $92,000 of income. Now, one of the questions that I've gotten a lot are, do we have to wait until the end of the year to get these tax credits? And the answer is no. If you qualify for the credits, you'll be able to get the monthly, so it will help immediately offset the cost of that insurance.
And in a country with a median family income in the low 50,000s range, that captures most American families, that 400% of poverty, doesn't it?
Yes. Many of the people who go to the exchanges who don't have insurance will be able to get some kind of a subsidy, some kind of help to help them pay for insurance. In many cases, it'll be possibly almost equivalent to what they would get if they had help coming from an employer. That's the idea.
All week we've been fielding questions from people who've asked us about things they still don't understand that it's in the law. Let's take a listen.
I'm Michelle Toro from Pembroke Pines, Florida, and my question is, how will the tax credits affect those uninsured?
Is this different if you are not working right now?
No, basically it's the same. If you go to the exchange, if you're uninsured, or if you buy your own insurance, again, it's important to remember that the exchanges are not really for people who have insurance at their jobs. It's for people who are in what we call the individual market, people who buy their insurance on their own without the help of an employer, or people who are uninsured who don't have insurance, don't have access to employer-provided insurance. And again, all of those people who go to the exchange will be eligible for these subsidies, these tax credits, if they are between 100% of poverty and 400% of poverty. Their income.
We've also been getting questions online. One comes from Bob S., who writes, you say you're going to explain Obamacare. Explain Title IX of Obamacare. Title IX is the revenue section. It contains 23 new taxes. What is Obamacare going to cost us tax-wise?
Well, the short answer is that when Obamacare passed, it was estimated to cost about $1 trillion over 10 years, and everybody agreed that it would not add to the deficit, so indeed there are a lot of taxes to pay for it. And these taxes basically were they tried to spread them as widely as they could, so everybody would have to pay a little bit. There are a number of new taxes on people who are wealthier, who earn more than $200,000 as an individual or $250,000 as a couple. There's an increase in their Medicare payroll tax. There's increases in taxes on their unearned income. There are also increases in things like there's a 10% tax on indoor tanning services. That's to deter people from doing that. It's considered relatively dangerous and possibly could lead to skin cancer. There are also taxes on many pieces of the healthcare system. There's a new tax on medical device manufacturers, on health insurers themselves, on pharmaceutical manufacturers. I might add that all of them are complaining and would like to see those taxes either reduced or taken away.
But again, that $1 trillion is over the course of the first decade of the law.
Yes, it is.
We got a question involving the mandates, because that was one of the most controversial parts of this law, that you would be required to enter the insurance market. Let's take a look.
I'm Kevin Brown. I'm from Primgar, Iowa, and I've got a friend that's uninsured, and I guess I'm just kind of worried what's going to happen with the premiums and how the fines work, really.
Do we know yet how the fines are going to work, how they're going to be levied, how high they're going to be?
Yes, we've known this from the beginning, but also a source of great confusion. The first year, if you don't have insurance at tax time in 2015, this is if you don't have insurance in 2014, the fine is $95 or 1% of your taxable income, whichever is greater. That fine goes up over several years. Eventually, it becomes $695 or 2.5% of your income. Now, there are a lot of people who won't be subject to the fine if they don't have insurance. If, for instance, if you don't make enough money to have to file federal income taxes, that's about $10,000 for an individual, about $20,000 for a couple. Those people are exempt from the requirement to have insurance. There are also certain people, if you're not here legally, you're obviously exempt from it. If you're a member of certain religious orders, you're exempt from the mandate. If buying the lowest cost insurance that's available would cost more than 8% of your gross income, you're also exempt from that. So those people would not have to purchase insurance and therefore would not have to pay the fine.
When you're designing a fine, it has to be high enough to hurt and not so low that the person would say, oh, then I'll gladly pay the fine. Instead, how did they negotiate that sweet spot?
Well, there's a concern from the insurance industry that indeed this fine is not big enough, that a lot of people will simply pay the fine rather than purchase insurance. But there's also, you know, one of the goals of this law is to make insurance more affordable, that people will want insurance and that they will go out and buy insurance because insurance, they will think insurance is a good and important thing to have. Remember, if you pay the fine, yeah, you're not going to pay that much, but you're also not going to have health insurance.
Julie Rovner of NPR, thanks again.
Thank you.